The name of this video is Uniformly Polarized Sphere. Part 5. This is the last video on the uniformly polarized sphere and also the last video about dielectric materials. So how do we complete this problem of the uniformly polarized sphere? The key idea here is to use a self-consistent method where in the previous video, part 4, we hypothesized that P, the polarization vector, is uniform if E naught, the external field which generates the polarization, is uniform. So if E naught is uniform, also capital P is uniform. That's our hypothesis. And capital P, in the case of a uniformly polarized sphere, for each value of R less or equal small r than capital R, where capital R is the radius of the sphere, under these conditions, we know that capital P is uniform, and we know that the depolarizing field, that is EP, the reaction or depolarizing or polarization field, is negative, is minus capital P uniform divided by 3 times epsilon naught. In addition, we know that the sphere is made of an ILH material, and therefore the key equations that apply in this case are that capital P for an ILH is equal to chi, the electric susceptibility of this material, times E, whereas capital D, the free auxiliary vector D, is given by epsilon times E for ILH materials. Particularly, we know that chi is given by epsilon minus epsilon naught. Let's call this epsilon d here for the electric material, whereas epsilon d is equal to epsilon rd times epsilon naught. So we can call this chi also d, to be completely precise. What is this field E? This is the total field in the dielectric material. So let's put also here a subscript d everywhere. And this also, let's call it dd, as we've done in a previous example. P, we call it P. So chi d, which is the susceptibility of this material, is epsilon d minus epsilon naught. Epsilon d is epsilon rd times epsilon naught. P is chi d times E, d, and dd is epsilon d times ed in the dielectric material. This is true for ILH materials. Now, if this is the case, what is, by means of the superposition principle, the total field E inside ed, ed inside the dielectric material? So ed, we use a similar notation for the parallel plate capacitor, ed is the electric field, the total electric field within the dielectric material, d subscript for dielectric. So this ed, by means of linear superposition, has to be E naught, which is the vacuum field, the external field generated by free sources, by free charges, linearly superimposed with ep, where we know, by substituting ep from this expression here, down here, we find eventually that ED is equal to E naught minus P divided by 3 epsilon naught. So this finally we can write it as E naught minus chi D times ED divided by 3 times epsilon naught, where we have used the fact that P is chi d times ed from here. So we use this expression here, in here. What is the aim of this problem now? The self-consistent method is aiming, so our final goal, as I mentioned in part 4, is to find E d as a function of E naught, dd as a function of E naught, and p as a function of E naught. And why is that? Because the handle, as an experimentalist, we have in our hands is actually E naught. And why is that? Because actually the handle really we have in our hands are the free charges on the conductors. We inject these free charges on conductors, we charge them, for example, by applying potential differences. We know that they are related by means of the capacitance. So that's the procedure. We apply potential differences by means of capacitance. Effectively, we are tuning up the charges, and so effectively we are tuning up our field E naught. So that's our handle. That's what we have in our hands. So the aim is to find all these fields in the electric material, capital P, E, D, and D, D, as a function of the only knob we have, which is E naught. That's the aim of all this video. Okay. So now, this we can manipulate it a little bit, and we can write, since the key items here are that ED is equal to E naught minus something which is proportional to ED. So we can bring this quantity minus something which is proportional to ED on the left-hand side, factor out ED, therefore obtaining ED as a function of E naught. And so if we do that, remember that the sign changes, and remember that this chi D is actually epsilon D minus epsilon naught. So we're going to get ED plus, when I bring it to the other side. Now, chi D is epsilon D, but epsilon D is epsilon RD times epsilon naught, so this epsilon naught cancels out. And so we have plus, what is left of chi D is epsilon RD minus 1, because we got rid of the epsilon naught, so this is left of chi D, divided by 3. So I cancel the epsilon naught, times ED. This has to be equal to E naught. Therefore, from this eventually, we find that ED so if I factor it out, I get 1 plus epsilon RD minus 1 divided by 3. So if you do the algebra, you will find that ED is equal to 3 times 3 times is in the denominator, but when I bring it to the other side, it goes in the numerator. I'm just inverting for ED, so it should be pretty simple. Divided by 2 times 2 plus epsilon RD times E naught. So finally, by means of this method, we were able to find the relationship between ED and the knob we have in our hands, which is E naught. So ED is a function of E naught. So that's the first step. So obviously, finding as a consequent dd as a function of E naught is straightforward, because we can use the definition given up here of dd, which is epsilon d times E naught, and so we obtain simply 3 times epsilon rd times epsilon naught, which is epsilon d, divided by 2 times 2 plus epsilon rd times E naught. So this is the second expression we were looking for, dd, as a function of R knob, which again is E naught. What is the last expression we want to find? It's the most important one, perhaps, and why is that? Because we want to verify that how our uniformity hypothesis from part 4 is actually correct. And also, we want to verify whether it's true or not that this ILH material is rigid or not. What does it mean, rigid? It means that the ILH is such that P depends only on E naught, okay? Which is our external knob. So as it turns out, capital P can be readily obtained by multiplying ED times chi D, as we know from this expression here. And so let's spell out chi D as epsilon D minus epsilon naught. And so we obtain 3 times in the numerator times chi D. Chi D is actually epsilon naught that multiplies epsilon rd minus 1. So note that again, I factor out an epsilon naught. So if I do so, here I'm left with epsilon rd and this minus 1. So that's chi d in this parenthesis here times epsilon naught. So 3 times chi d divided by 2 plus epsilon rd, the whole quantity multiplied times E naught. So this is an amazing result, in my opinion. And why is that? Because first, it confirms that actually, indeed, the uniformity is correct. P is uniform. Which confirms our hypothesis. So instead of solving an Avogadro number of second Euler equations to take into account for the transient, we were able in this self-consistent method by a simple assumption of uniformity and assuming that EP is uniform and given by minus P over 3 epsilon naught, where did we find this? In part 1, 2, and 3, assuming uniformity, assuming that P was uniform. So that's the only assumption. As long as I can assume that P is uniform, I can find this result. Linear superposition, self-consistently, I find P as a function of E0 is also uniform, because E0 is uniform and this is just a constant. In addition, the other beautiful thing which we end up showing here is that it's also a rigid material. And in fact, P depends only on E0, not on ED or some recursive fashion. So this is beautiful, uniform and rigid. This is one of the most beautiful problems or type of problems in my opinion, for dielectric materials and electromagnetism in general. So, now, as always, it's worth three things. I will give you a Piazza assignment in a minute, but we should do sanity checks. So what are the sanity checks? So the first sanity check is to assume that we are in vacuum. So if we are in vacuum, so suppose that epsilon RD is equal to 1, that is, we substitute the dielectric sphere with vacuum, okay? So clearly, what do we expect in this case? Well, the first thing we expect is that capital P has to be equal to 0, right? Because in vacuum, we must have 0. Is that correct? Well, let's substitute here. 1, 1 minus 1 is 0, the rest are constants, this is 0, which is great. In vacuum, we cannot polarize vacuum. In addition, what about dd? Well, dd, we expect to be basically the dd of vacuum. And in fact, if we do so, epsilon rd is equal to 1, 2 plus 1 is 3, 3 and 3 cancel out, and so beautifully we obtain epsilon naught times E naught, which is expected, this dd in vacuum. So this is actually equal to d naught. So check with this one as well. So this is an important sanity check. The other thing, the two sanity checks I wanted to make, in Piazza, I would like that you solve the same problem for infinite slab. Using this self-consistent method. What is the total ED in an infinite slab? You should use this, it's actually easier than this because here we have minus P over 3 epsilon naught. What is EP for an infinite slab? I will let you do that. The last little part which we didn't cover yet is what happens when R, for completeness, is larger or equal than capital R. Well, we already know what is the answer from part 1, 2, and 3. It's basically the dielectric sphere behaves as if you were a single effective dipole with dipole moment small p equal capital P times the volume of the sphere. And so let me remind you that. So effectively, so it's an effective dipole, electric dipole, and the dipole moment small p is given by capital P times the volume of the sphere, which is 4/3 pi r³. You've seen this in part 1, 2, and 3. So it's an effective dipole center in the center of the sphere. The solution is beautiful and perfect in this case because it's actually an ideal or quasi-ideal dipole. So the solution outside for completeness now, the total solution, E, D, let's just call it E because D, let's use D for only within the sphere. E is now outside the sphere. So this is linear superposition of E naught, which is, of course, the uniform external field, plus the field of a dipole, which we know it's 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught. And here we can keep the equal because these really are ideal dipoles. It's an ideal effective dipole. So it's ideal, or to be more precise, it's quasi-ideal. But let's just call it ideal for simplicity, 4 pi epsilon naught. And so what do we have here? We have the usual expression we already know for E, which is 3 times p small p dot small r, where small p is given by this quantity, is uniform, times this goes in the direction of r, divided by r5. So this is the radial direction. What about the other component is plus minus the p component, so p divided by r³. So we have seen this a number of times before. So this is the field outside. In part 1 and 2 and 3, we only found this result, which is the effective dipole, and now we need to superimpose it with E0. So that's exactly the only difference compared to part 1, 2, and 3, which we add this E0. So this is the field E outside. But of course there is vacuum, and therefore the NPP is zero, and the it's equal to epsilon naught E naught in this case. Okay, great. So now that we know all this, let's, of course, to make an actual plot, you should plot it, for example, using console or something like this. So I've done it for you. And so the plot looks something like this. So if this is our parallel plate capacitor, which is ideal. So this is the wall, which is charged positively. And this is the wall, which is charged negatively. So let me remind you that these are the two conductive walls. So this one is minus sigma F, and this one is plus sigma F. Within this capacitor, we have our sphere, which looks like this. And so within the sphere, we have a uniform, which we verify, the P. Say these are some of the field lines of the uniform P, which now we completely verified. So also the field, the total field ED, it's as such, of course, this field ED, is it larger or smaller than E naught? Of course, it's smaller because there is partial screening. In fact, 3 divided by 2 plus something larger than 1 means that it is smaller than E naught. So here we have a field ED. This is our ED, which is smaller than E naught, which makes lots of sense that it's smaller than E naught because of this partial screening. Okay, so there is partial screening here. What about outside? Outside, of course, is like a dipole, but with a uniform field. And so if you plot it, it looks something like this. So if you're far away from the sphere, basically, you don't even notice that there is such a sphere. Then eventually you start to notice it, and so you start to see some deviation of the field lines in this fashion. And of course it's symmetric on the other side, so I'm not going to sketch it there. And here, when you go very close to the sphere, they start to deviate even more, so the field becomes highly non-uniform in this region here. And of course here is like this. Perfect. So these are exactly the field lines which are symmetric on the other side. And again, so here the field is, after the superposition, very non-uniform. Inside remains uniform, and there is partial screening, which is worth writing down. Inside there is partial screening, which is, again, a very important qualitative point that you really want to always check, and is driven by this equation here for ED, which is quite nice. Okay, so to recap this video, uniform parallel sphere, the last video which summarizes everything. So in the first three videos, we hypothesized that capital P is uniform. Great, capital P is uniform, somebody gives it to me. We know that it must be generated by some E naught, but at that point we didn't care. So assuming that, we found a depolarizing field, see all the arguments of part 1, 2, and 3, where this EP is minus, makes sense, partial screening, P over 3 epsilon naught. Great. Now, actually we know that this is generated by a field E naught due to some free charges, like this over capacitor here. So the actual field ED in the dielectric has to be the linear superposition of EP and E naught. So we hypothesize that if E naught is uniform, P is also uniform, and so we use this result and we check at the end that this makes sense. So by doing so, we loop the linear superposition, we manipulate it by means of this definition in ILH, and we find an expression for ED and ED, which allows us also for ILH to find an expression for P. P is only a function of E naught, which means the material is also rigid, not only ILH, but also rigid, and is uniform because it's a constant times E naught. So the hypothesis is confirmed, the problem is solved. Remember that actually there is a transient during which at the beginning this EP is zero, then it builds up, because all the dipoles start to align, until they align in such a way that they generate a screening field which partially screens E naught. So that's, and this is the steady result of all these alignments which take time over a time span of tau, the transient time, which is pretty short, very short. Okay, so these are the main results of this video. Sanity check, what happens in vacuum? P has to be zero. That makes sense. Outside, linear superposition of E naught plus the field of an effective dipole ideal, and this ideal effective dipole has to have a small p, which is capital P times the volume of the sphere. See the first set of videos for dielectric materials. We superimpose it, and when you plot it, this is what it looks like. Okay? And so inside the sphere, of course, it is smaller, partial screening. So with this, we conclude our long series of videos on dielectric materials, which in my opinion is conceptually the hardest chapter of this course. Now we're going to start magnetic materials, which actually is very, very similar to dielectric materials. So if you understood dielectric materials, it will be rather easy to understand magnetic materials. The hardest job was to understand the electromagnetics. That's it.